Now, the Philippine Senate is on track to pass a proposed 4.1 trillion peso or $81 billion national budget for 2020. Finance Committee Chair Sonny Angara made that clear, saying they want to submit the General Appropriations Bill to President Duterte by mid-December. The Senate officially begins the plenary debates on the spending bill today. Angara wants the 2020 budget passed on time. He cites the slowdown in the Philippine economy for the first half of the year due to the delayed approval of the 2019 budget. As the Senate gears up for the plenary debates on the 2020 budget, Senator Panfilo Lacson warns of another impasse. That's if House lawmakers push for what he calls a sneaky 100 billion peso insertion in the spending bill. Lacson says it was House Speaker Alan Peter Cayetano himself who mentioned that insertion.
Totoo nga yung suspecta ko rin na mayroon pa sila nakatago na sa paygam nila ipapasok. Eh, yung 100 billion pesos, napakalaking halaga, no? Madi-distort na yung entire budget kasi yung tatama ang mga ahensya na tatanggalan mo. Eh, paano yung kanilang mga priority projects na pinag-aralan na nila yun bago pa man na sila mag-budget ko? Mm-hmm. Eh, kasama na doon sa, at nakasama sa NEP. Tapos gagalawin ko yung ganung kalaking halaga. And mga kongresista na I doubt kung merong pagkukonsulta na ginawa sa mga ahensya na maapektuhan ng pagbawas at saka pagdagdag.
To assist them.
A deadlock had delayed the passage of the 2019 budget due to accusations among lawmakers of allegedly anomalous insertions. Those insertions were eventually vetoed by President Duterte. The Philippine economy can grow higher than 6% as long as the 2020 budget is passed on time. That's according to Eduardo Olbes, the executive vice president and head of wholesale banking segment at Security Bank. Gross domestic product grew 6.2% in the third quarter on the back of a recovery in government spending that was weighed down by the delayed approval of the 2019 budget.
I think there's been lessons learned in terms of the delayed budget approval last year. And so we see government acting to put the budget approvals in place in a more timely way. Our hope is that as government expenditures in infrastructure, which basically benefit the construction sector, as those expenditures come online, then you should see benefits ripple across the economy.
Technologies become increasingly crucial in running a business, whether enterprise level or as a micro, small, and medium-sized company. And that includes automating processes, including payroll. Our next guest is the CEO of Upraxis Global, an investment vehicle founded in 2012 that builds enterprise-grade cloud products and services. He is also the CEO and founder of JustPayroll, Upraxis' flagship service. David Bell joins us now here in the studio. Good to have you with us, David.
Thank you very much for having me. Program. Thank you.
So you make money off businesses who need payroll services that are automated. So this one's go on digital transformation journeys. But how important is it that
Indeed.
The payroll systems are digitalized?
Indeed, absolutely. So we have some really good customers in the Philippines. We have some very small ones, but also some big enterprises. And particularly for the enterprise clients, it's a major transformation for those individual companies. Because essentially, one of the biggest roles of a company is to obviously make money, but also to pay their employees. And it's our mission to make sure that the payroll is accurate, on time, and it's done at the least amount of effort by the organization.
And among those big enterprises, Amazon Philippines counts as one of them.
We do
indeed. And you provide business process outsourcing services to them. How many new customers have you had this year
in terms
of BPO services?
So we're looking to exit the year around about 70,000 end employees on platform, and that's across all of our segments, so the small segment, the medium, and also the enterprise.
But
so
what about in terms of the BPO clients? Because there's been some struggle with the expansion efforts of BPOs
Indeed.
Because of the Sitira tax reform bill. How did that impact you?
Absolutely. When the train two, I guess, was announced, there was a lot of hesitation in our clients because we're thinking, how does this affect us as a business community? And ultimately, they've invested quite a lot in PESA and invested in going through PESA certification. And are wondering, is this really relevant for us as an organization anymore? So I think they've gone through a lot of round of deliberation with accountants and their lawyers. And I think it's very interesting that the PESA Director General announced last week that they were very positive about the reforms. So I think they're going through a process to really realize that it is a good thing for them. I think they're realizing that ultimately moving the tax rate from 30% all the way down to 20% makes them more competitive. So it
but
makes the Philippines...
Did that slow business? I mean, I understand 40% of your business is in business process outsourcing.
Indeed. So it's an interesting one because ultimately clients look at the Philippines not just because of the corporation tax. They look at other factors such as the English-speaking population. They look at the telecoms in the country. They look at the ease of doing business more generally. And I think the corporation tax rate is a factor, but it's probably not a primary factor that customers look to towards the Philippines to provide them. But ultimately, we have to be competitive as an economy, and moving towards a 20% is a big step forward.
So what about the 60% of your customers? I mean, how did that get on for the rest of this year, given the policy developments we've seen in the Philippines, including the telecommuting law, as well as ENDO, the ending of the contracting in the labor code?
Absolutely, and it's growth. So in all of our clients, we're seeing significant growth in the accounts.
How significant?
I think there's actually a very new nascent euphoria in the market, I think, about taking on new staff. And we see there's double-digit growth in a lot of our accounts, you know, and particularly in the regions. So we've had clients come to us in Cebu and Davao, so regions we haven't really necessarily served strongly before in the past, with a lot of renewed interest.
And are these MSMEs or enterprise grade?
It's a combination.
The ratio is 50-50, or do you see that changing in the next 2 to 3 years?
It's actually more enterprise. So it's more of a foreign enterprises coming to the Philippines, looking as a destination for a back office. So being able to tap the amazing talent in the country, you know, that speaks English, that's on a reasonable time zone, that that is very, very willing to adapt to the needs of the global corporates. So they're actually coming in spades to the Philippines.
It's a competitive space out there. I mean, I just Google payroll, and I come up with a huge number of competitors. You've got Solarium, you've got Sprout. I mean, what is your value proposition to the customers out there that defines your presence in the online space?
Absolutely right. And it's very interesting, this space, because we have operations also in the UK. So we have a sister business called Solutio.com in the UK that deals with the contingent workforce. So we've taken a lot of the learnings that we've had in the UK and we've placed them here in the Philippines. What I realized in the Philippines is the barrier to entry in enterprise payroll is very high. So we see a lot of entrants coming into the market, and we see our customers replacing existing systems because they're not fit for purpose for their growing operations. So what we provide is a enterprise grade, scalable product that can grow as our customer grows.
And you know, that word scalability is very important, because when you talk about legacy systems, you've got to iterate your own software to make sure that they're matched.
Absolutely right.
They're aligned. So how are you catching up?
We spend a lot of money on R&D. We have some amazing engineers in our Makati office, and we constantly think about how do we best serve our customer. One example I'd use is trying to move support away from telephones onto online chat. Because if you face it, millennials love to use a chat. They don't necessarily want to pick up a phone and call someone. So we're actually rolling out into our customers the ability to do really interesting AI-enabled chat. And this is from our rolling program of R&D. Many more things in the pipeline, but it's all about providing a new major feature to our customers every quarter, and that's our commitment to them.
Then comes a problem with cybersecurity. I mean, you're putting a whole load of data out there in the
Indeed.
Online space. So then comes a problem of the potential cyber theft. So
Indeed.
How can you ensure your customers that their privacy is safe?
Indeed. Well, we've spent a lot of money and effort getting an SSA 18 certified. So it's a certification given by PwC and to us, which really guarantees that the data within our company is accurate, it's secure, but also it's the privacy is a top priority. We do every quarter we do a penetration test, so we get some ethical hackers from the outside world to try and get into our systems, and we go through a rigorous process of compliance. But ultimately, our business is at stake if we have any attacks on our system. So that is a number one priority as a CEO, to make sure our customer data is 100% safe.
Final point, and you made a mention of it, the ease of doing business law. I mean, you set up shop here in 2012.
Indeed.
And that didn't exist. I mean, the ease of doing business law came into effect last year. The IRR came into effect this year. A couple of months after that, the anti-red tape chief.
Indeed.
Is it any bit easier to do business here? What are you feeling on the ground?
We haven't really seen a big difference, really, because we have a lot of our clients come to us to help incorporate their companies and help set up their payroll with the BIR, with DOLE, with other agencies. And it's very difficult on the ground to comply. And I think a point I make about ease of doing business, it's not just when you set up the company. Ease of doing business is all through the life cycle of the company. So things like audits, the telecoms, you make sure you have effective telecommunications in the country to make sure that any DOLE regulations are reflected immediately back into your practices. So ease of doing business is a broader topic than I think we've talked about previously.
So are you going to be hiring more this year and next?
100%, absolutely.
By how much?
Well, we have 150 people in our Makati office, and unfortunately we've reached the limit of our real estate at the moment. But we're actually doing some really good practices such as work from home. So one of the telecommuting act's priority is to try and get some traffic away from ETSA, essentially. And we have a program in place where we're hiring developers and other individuals to work from home. So we want to leverage the good things that the government is doing to try and help us grow our business.
Is it just the Philippines, or are you going to be regionalizing in the next couple of years, focusing on the ASEAN market?
Absolutely. Well, we have operations, really good operations in the UK already, which are going very well. Hopefully we'll get
despite
market
Brexit.
Leadership. So Brexit is actually an enabler of our business, because ultimately when the economic forecasts are gloomy, employers move towards temporary workers. So our system supports the temporary worker. So ultimately, it's good where there's the economy goes down in the UK. Likewise, when the economy goes up, we get more permanent workers.
So it's just UK and the Philippines right now?
UK, Philippines. We're also having conversations about some other markets in Southeast Asia. But ultimately, what we do with Just Payroll is equally applicable to other markets. And it's a very exciting time to be in this industry.
All right, let us know the developments as you regionalize the business. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Kathy.
David Bell of Just Payroll here in the studio. Well-